Hi, I'm Deborah Atkinson, and this is Flipping 50, the place to be to tune up, prepare, and reset for your second and better half with the vitality and the energy that you want. In every episode, I answer questions from women just like you about what they're struggling with most, and I share how to move, what to eat, and small daily flips that you can make so you can get the most results in the least amount of time. And I'd love to answer your question. Head on over to flipping50tv.com and send it to me. If I choose your question, you get some juicy gifts I'm going to tell you a little bit more about at the end of the episode. Even if I don't choose your question, you right away, as a thanks, get my Muscles in Minutes guide to the best exercises for boosting metabolism after 50 or any time. Today's question comes from Karla, who writes, I just turned 50 this month. Happy birthday. In 2013, I fractured my L4 and L5, and that's your lower back, your lumbar spine, for those of you listening who may not know. Since then, I've had trouble finding exercise to help with my abs because I can't do sit-ups and crunches. What do you recommend? I work in an office at a desk 8 hours a day. Karla says, I'm afraid to try anything and I'm continuing to gain weight. We're going to tackle all of it, but I want to tell all of you right now that Karla's actually at an advantage that she may not realize. Sit-ups and crunches are not a girl's best friend, not a guy's best friend for that matter, and it has nothing to do with whether you're over 50 or you're 20. So we're going to give Karla some great exercises outside of crunches and sit-ups, and you should be doing those too. Karla, we're gonna dive in. We've got three things we're gonna cover today. And in segment number one, when we're talking about muscles in minutes, I'm gonna give you a great sequence of exercises that you can do safely so that you can stabilize the spine. So here's what they're gonna do. Keep you safe, keep you sane, because they don't take a lot of time, and flatten the belly in the way that we want them to. We're gonna go into the kitchen and we'll be talking Minute Maid. And our whole purpose there is to help you decrease or keep down inflammation. So when you've got a lot of things going on and you've had previous pain and or you're more aware of it and a little fearful of being in pain again, and I totally get that, we wanna make sure we're doing everything to keep that inflammation down internally, because that also is gonna help you slim and slender and flatten the belly. Last but not least, we wanna make you an overnight success. When you've got pain or you have a tendency toward some prior injury that's causing inflammation, we wanna make sure that we're doing everything we can to help prevent weight gain, to help the belly fat, by getting you a good night's sleep. Right now, your self rating of your sleep is a 5, and you're only getting 6 hours of sleep. Now, some people actually can thrive on that, and that is their need, but I'm gonna encourage you to do a sleep needs test. Work on a few nights when you can go to sleep when your body tells you to. No screens. If you're reading a book, see what time that is. When you get tired, actually go to sleep. Write that time down. Keep it dark, keep it cool, and keep it quiet, and wake up naturally. And when you know what that is, you'll have a better idea of where your sleep need is, and you can compare that to the 6 hours that you're getting right now. And the ideal is that your number, your rating of the quality of that sleep, no matter how long it is, goes up. And that's gonna help you. So let's tackle all three of those, starting with muscles in minutes. Karla, you're in luck. So number one, I know you can't do crunches and sit-ups, and you may think that that's a disadvantage, and actually it's a huge advantage. Crunches and sit-ups, if you're listening at home and you have nothing wrong with your L4 and your L5, no back issues, and maybe you're under the belief that, or the assumption that crunches and sit-ups are exactly what's getting you great results, I'm gonna beg to differ. And here's what we know. The research is there that shows us the risk ratio, the risk reward ratio of crunches and sit-ups just is not there in favor of them. There's so much more risk of lower back issues, specifically with the discs in that low L4, L5 lumbar spine area, that by doing them, we're causing more harm than good. And here's why, because there are dozens of other exercises that don't come with that risk and do come with reward. And we don't know that we're doing damage even when we are. So you or me, we could do sit-ups and crunches. That's not the problem. We can do them comfortably, at least not for our core maybe, but our lower back isn't gonna feel any problem. And we can be under the assumption that that's what's getting us results, when it's probably consistency of exercise and consistency of core focus maybe getting you results. But we know that if you have a thicker spine, and we can't really tell that, right? Unless we've done some bone density testing or you've had x-rays, we might be able to look at your frame and say, you're probably more at risk because you've got a thicker frame. Maybe when we put your fingers together around your wrist, you actually can't touch, so you do have a larger frame. I probably am a little less at risk than some people with a smaller frame. However, really important that you know, no matter what kind of a spine or thickness of bone you have, we're all accelerating our path to injury by doing crunches and sit-ups. It's going to happen. We only have so many forward flexions in us. That's the truth. And the problem with a disc issue is most people don't know until they have pain and it's too late. So if you're gonna have a problem with your back, it usually is not something that you're waking up in the morning and you're feeling like, oh, I'm stiff, that might be true. That's related to something else. That's probably a little bit more arthritis prone, but your disc plump overnight, putting you at more risk when you're doing exercise first thing in the morning. So two things that you do need to abide by, whether it's you, Karla, or it's you at home, is wait an hour after you wake to exercise of any kind. There is movement and there is what we call moment pressure. And that means shoveling, pushing the vacuum cleaner, pushing a broom, mowing the lawn, not electric. All of those things are pressure. So planks even, yoga, things that you might think are gentle, still are risk prone. And anything that's got forward flexion or rotation, also not good. So Karla, what we're gonna do today is about 9 exercises, pretty simply, that get you focused on the real type of exercise that actually builds you in and creates a flatter stomach anyway. So let's get to it. And for those of you that are really curious about some of those things that I just talked about, I'm gonna link to a podcast episode that I did with Dr. Stuart McGill, who is a world-renowned back pain prevention expert, all about what we've just talked about. Okay, so Karla, you said you're sitting at your desk for about 8 hours a day. Now, I'm in a really low chair compared to probably what you're sitting in at your desk, but for demonstration purposes, what I want to show you is what happens when you just hold yourself upright and when you lift up one leg, even if you don't hold on with your arms. Can you feel what happens in here? Your core braces. And when you brace, it's not a hollowing in or suck your belly into the spine. And if you're still hearing that, I want you to ignore those cues and walk away. Run, in fact. What we want to do is not hollow in and tuck, because that actually makes you weaker. Your core is weaker, cannot protect your lower back. What we want is bracing. So if you put your hands right here and then you lift one knee, you've braced and you've gotten a little bit more tension. If somebody were gonna throw a ball at you and you were gonna catch it and it was heavy, you would brace. Your muscles tighten in order to protect your lower back. Nobody has to tell you to do it. So what we're gonna do is try to apply some exercises with that same philosophy. So this just simple knee raise, knee lift while you're sitting in your chair, leaning back very slightly onto your tailbone with still a nice flat back, but lifting one at a time, and or lifting it up and holding it for a little bit longer without any arms. They're there to spot you if you need them, but even that can be bracing and core exercise. So mid-morning and mid-afternoon, Karla, once if not twice, take a little posture break and work on bracing. Nobody even needs to know you're doing this with your legs lifting under the desk, but you can wake up that spine and perk up your posture a little bit and feel much more comfortable and like you are actively engaging and doing something good for yourself. We're to come down to the floor. So that was bracing in a seated knee lift. And we're gonna end with that one too. But I want you to come down and we're gonna talk about planks. So the ever popular plank exercise. And when you're starting out, what I'm gonna have you do is go from knees to the crown of your head and keep that your lever. Now, those of you who are a little bit more advanced, you can go for a straight leg and actually lift. So from your heels to the crown of your head, that's your lever, but that's much more difficult than starting here. So I want you to do the one you can do really well first. And I've already worn out my welcome. So as I'm doing plank right there, remember that anytime you need your core to protect you from a lower back injury, what you really need is for your core to turn on when you need it. Because typically what happens is we bend over to pick up the dog food. We do something we almost never do, or we do something that we do every single day and we're shocked that we got injured doing it. And part of the reason is our muscles are not turning on to protect us when we bend over to pick up the dog or pick up the baby or put a baby in a bassinet or take your groceries and put them in the trunk or get them back out of the trunk. What we need then is the muscles to turn on. So let me show you, instead of doing a one long holding plank, I want you to practice doing 10 or 15 seconds of a plank, either in this down position or in this up position. And then when you've held it for 10 or 15 seconds, come out of it, let the muscles relax. You can come down and rest on your belly if you're not turning to face me, and then come up and do it again. Because the most important part of that was the first half second when you got up here in the first place and let those muscles come on. So between, for you, it might look like this. Just coming down, let the muscles relax, and then come back up and turn back on. So instead of doing a minute and focusing on why in the world you can't, try doing four sets of say 15 seconds or even six sets of 10 seconds. It's a smarter way to start training your core. Gradually, you can lengthen the time that you're holding. So then it's 15 seconds times four, 20 seconds times three, 30 seconds times two, until your muscles are more strong. And that's a great way to start. The next exercise I'm gonna do for you is a single leg march. Now this is one you probably, if you've been at Flipping 50 TV with me, you've seen it before. Too many times, maybe you're thinking, Deborah. But it's not that I'm not creative. It's that it's one of my favorites. And your spine is protected. It's on the floor. It's great for beginners. And if you're a beginner, what I want you to do is to keep your lower back on the floor. Because what you're doing, if you put your hands right here, you're not sucking in, you're not drawing your navel to your spine. You're simply feeling a target. So your muscles are braced right here. And if I said, all right, now I'm more advanced, been doing this for a while, you're gonna put a small arch underneath the small of your back. So I could send mail from here to here, essentially. Not a lot of mail, just a little mail. Small package, and up, and down, and lift and down. And the goal is, this is not moving while this is moving. And that's the whole point. So the legs, it's not about exercising them. It's about making them pull on you such that you have to stay stable. And a great set of those is 15, doing right and left, one, right and left, two, okay? Next up, we're gonna do a side leg raise. And I'm gonna step out of the camera just for a second, grab a ball, and I'll be right back. So if you have a ball, go grab one. If you don't, go get a pillow, and you can use that instead, okay? On your side, what I want you to do is to come down. You're gonna put that right between your legs. You're gonna make sure that you're not lying on the microphone. And as you come down, protect your head and neck. But what I want you to do is to squeeze the ball between your legs and raise up. Now, I happen to have one of those grocery store balls that probably cost 99 cents. If you have a big exercise ball at home, you could be using that instead. What I'm doing here is really what's called lateral flexion. So the movement is not great here,
but it is working. And these muscles in my obliques do a lot of side or lateral flexion, and we don't move that way very often. By the way, that exercise in the gym, standing with a weight, dropping down to your side, bending and flexing, leave that one out. 1980 called and wants it back. Here we go, lift and down. And this one looks deceptively easy, but you'll find that you definitely have a difference in strength on one side and the other. So pay attention to that, because we want you as balanced as possible. So if they're really out of order or out of balance, you can do 5 and 1, 10 on the other really easily. We want to bring them closer so that you can do about 10 on both sides. And release. Coming up to all fours. This is one of my favorites and one of the oldest. On all fours, knees right under your hips, palms right under your shoulders, and if this bothers your wrists, you can either skip this one or you might want to try and keep your wrists straight by going on the knuckles. Totally up to you. From this one, what you're doing is extending the opposite arm and leg. So this one is not about maximum strength, not even about maximum endurance, but it is about balancing the muscles that run up and down like a zipper right next to your spine. And what we want to happen here is that we're not falling over, we're staying nice and neutral, meaning both shoulders and both hips are still parallel to the floor. And as you extend, this is one of the most passive feeling exercises that is probably one of the most beneficial if you've got back injuries and you really need to strengthen that back. That one's called bird dog, super simple. Lying with weight. So this one is not very creative name-wise, certainly, but it is reminiscent of a strength training exercise for the back. You're gonna be lying down. And I want you to get creative and imaginative with me, because you can also do this one standing with your hips, your shoulders, and your head against the wall. And you can take a weight and raise it up to tap the wall. Don't remove any plaster. And then bring it down right in front of you. We're gonna inhale and then exhale. So the point here is really not that I have a heavy enough weight that I'm working my back, but the point is that I have a heavy enough weight that I'm gonna remove my hand from the handle here, and I want you to watch. As I take that weight up and overhead, my lower back wants to do this. So what I'm doing is stabilizing by not allowing it to move. And that, again, the whole point. So a lot of times the best core work is moving your arms or your legs in a way that makes you want to move your lower back. But if you're stabilizing, that's the work. And when you think about sitting all day, that's what your muscles are doing. So try and scoot to the edge of your seat, sit tall. Don't always use your back, but do use it sometimes for a break. Change your position often and you're gonna feel better. And remember how we started. So even if you are so-called stuck at a desk, writing it all day long, remember those simple knee raises, sitting at your desk. When you remove a base of support from the floor, you make yourself work even harder. Now I know some of you type A's gotta run to the finish line are thinking, well, could I lift them both? You could, but it changes things. Now your hip flexors have to work a lot harder, and you're not necessarily changing what's going on in here for the better, all right? So sometimes less is more. And that is your core exercise, Karla. It's a great battery, and I'm gonna link to a couple other episodes that'll help you with a whole repertoire of core exercises with no crunches and no sit-ups. This is tough love time. So we're gonna talk about what happens with inflammation and what happens when you don't eat breakfast and you have fast food for lunch and then you have a pretty good dinner. So it's not good. So especially if you're a female over 50, you need to look at starting your day outright. And if you have inflammation, you wanna look to
your spice cabinet and look at things like cinnamon and turmeric and start using them abundantly. So cinnamon, you can use on applesauce. You can use it on your oatmeal. You can put it in smoothies. You can use it in chili. So look for places where you can add it regularly. And with turmeric, a lot of Indian type of recipes are gonna use turmeric. And if you really wanna go full in, you might wanna look at taking a curcumin supplement. So you're gonna take it in pill form. And turmeric has a property in it that is the curcumin, that's the part that's the anti-inflammatory. But you have to have quite a bit of turmeric every day in order to get that amount. So if you really want to looking for something to help reduce inflammation, you might want to look at that. And then for sure, an omega-3 supplement. So we've talked quite a bit about supplements, and I'm going to share a link at my website for resources for the ones that I really love. And if you've got inflammation, you're not going to skip and pick and choose. You really want to pay attention to that. So it's also a great idea to try bone broth. So you're gonna get it in, but you're gonna be drinking it like you're drinking in your nutrients. Collagen can be really supportive of gut health and of helping to decrease inflammation that may or may not start or stop in the gut. But you could also potentially replace one of those cups of coffee in the morning with bone broth. That'd be a good start. A little bit of protein. And then the whole goal is to move you closer to actually having breakfast. So an easy way to do that is to start with a liquid breakfast like a smoothie. So start with some greens, some berries, some liquid in almond milk or coconut milk, and one of my faves. So if you're not doing dairy, and I recommend right now that you don't, what I'd like to see you doing is the Paleo Power or the Plant Power. Choose one or the other of those in vanilla or chocolate, whichever you're leaning toward most, and get started adding breakfast, and here's why. First of all, coffee, coffee, and coffee for breakfast are probably helping your cortisol do more damage than good. So by the time you get to lunch, you don't have any control over what your choices are. And that's part of the reason why you're shooting for fast food. So let's talk about that. Once you've got breakfast out of your way, lunch will, in part, start to take care of itself. But the whole thing is you've got to plan ahead. So you can pre-package, pre-put together your freezer bags of your greens, spinach, kale, a mixture of baby greens, romaine. All of those are great choices for greens. Your next thing is fat. Where are you gonna get that? You can put in nuts, you can put in nut butter, avocado, chia seeds and flax will add a little bit of fat as well. Or if you'd prefer it, you could just add a little bit of coconut oil right into your smoothie. Then you're gonna look for, where am I getting my fiber? Some of those other sources, double dip. So flax, chia, avocado, and berries also would add some fiber. So looking for how can you get everything you need at a meal, like protein and fat and fiber in a smoothie, it makes it super easy and super short on time consumption. So try that. That's gonna make it easier to get to lunch, but what I want you to start thinking about is optimizing the dinner. You're already doing a great job with that. So if, like a lot of people, you do tend to sit down to a protein source, vegetables, and a little bit of carbohydrate at dinner, and you're doing well there, cook once for many meals. And then invest in some things that you can easily take with you. So glass containers are best and easiest because you can reheat in them and they're not gonna absorb any toxins from plastics. Even if you're just refrigerating and not reheating in plastics, your food can absorb them. So glass is better, and then invest in an insulated carrying bag so you can bring lunch with you that you've made without any extra effort and take care of that fast food fix at lunch that's sabotaging you. So now you're covered with breakfast, with your lunch ideas, and you've already got dinner covered. So you're well on your way to reducing inflammation just because you're eating better ingesting a little less coffee and ingesting a little bit more inflammation prevention into your day. Karla, thanks so much for asking. And now I would love to hear your question. Send it to me at flipping50tv.com. And if I answer your question and use it for an episode, you're gonna get exclusive access to the After 50 Fitness Formula for Women, my online course, a copy of You Still Got It Girl, the book, and a trio of full-size products from my friends at Anne Marie Skincare. What are you waiting for? Head on over to flipping50tv.com. You have nothing to lose, because even as a thanks, right away, I'm gonna send you Muscles in Minute. It's my guide to toning those hard to tone areas. And if you've got cellulite, you're gonna love this. I'll see you on the flip side.